Penguin Random House presents Bipin, the Man Behind the Uniform by Rachna Bisht Rawat, read by Kulvin Suri. In early 1978, a slim and medium-built gentleman cadet at the Indian Military Academy, whom no one had noticed before, was being brutally thrashed by his much stronger opponent in the boxing ring. Bleeding profusely from the nose and mouth, bout after bout, he refused to give up and eventually went on to win. Surprised spectators wanted to know who the boy was. It was the shy and reticent gentleman cadet, Bipin Rawat of Zojila Company, who went on to become India's first Chief of Defence Staff. This is his story. Foreword by Lieutenant General Rakesh Sharma, former Adjutant General, General Bipin Rawat, Chair of Excellence, USI Distinguished Fellow, Vivekananda International Foundation. As crystal a memory can be, on 4th December 2021, in 5x11 Gorkha Rifles at Shankar Vihar, Bipin, Madhu, Payal and I were foreseeing ourselves sitting on rocking chairs next to a bonfire in Dehradun in our twilight years. It was not to be. On that fateful day, Madhu, though many of her friends called her Maddie, I could never do so, sent a picture with the unit Subedar Major on WhatsApp saying, "We'll call you in the evening." That evening was not to come. There were plans and plans that went a-begging. There are memories and memories, some so trivial that they do not merit recounting. At exercises, Utpal Roy, Durga Prasad, Bipin and I invariably carried lotas together for morning calls. Unimaginable today. I recollect that while doing pre-course training of 81mm mortars in 9 Dogra in US Club Kulaba, we suddenly heard the renowned baritone of Rajkumar, the famous actor who was playing golf there. We asked the NCO instructor permission to go and shake hands with the actor. The instructor was so annoyed that he made us both lift up a base plate each and go around the green on which Rajkumar was putting. The actor saw us and gave a hearty laugh, and we were embarrassed like hell. Of course, we shook hands and he obliged us by saying Jani in his inimitable way. Indeed, Bipin and I had differences, and some discussions sounded as if on the warpath. We differed and agreed in equal measure, discussed every known issue or personality threadbare. That was the strength of our relationship, always. It was a relationship that cannot have a suitable adjective. We visited each other at all our postings and at homes. General and Mrs. Lakshman Rawat were blessed to have Bipin and Madhu looking after them through their lives so well at Arun Vihar, Noida. I recall General Lakshman Rawat at the Flagstaff House at Baramulla when Bipin was commanding the division. This was the same house that General Lakshman Rawat had occupied in the early 80s. I have not seen in my life the kind of recognition that Bipin and Madhu got in their demise at 3 Kamraj Road, with swelling crowds, serpentine queues of the public at large, and people running along the cortege to Brar Square for the last rites. The Delhi-Haridwar road was lined with people with flowers as we were on our way with the last remains. And Haridwar itself. Such recognition comes to the rarest of the rare. And I recollect writing that phrase in the only confidential report that I had the greatest privilege writing on Bipin, as my second in command. Rachna Bisht Rawat has been most persuasive and forceful in putting together the life of Bipin in her inimitable way. When we first met, I recollect mentioning to her, "Do justice to my dearest friends." Anything short of that will be unacceptable to me. The outcome is an eminently readable book. The best compliment is that the first read moistened my eyes. Bipin and Madhu went so early, leaving indelible memories. So long, dear friends, till we meet again. Introduction. In August 2019, when the nation was commemorating the 20th anniversary of Operation Vijay, popularly known as the Kargil War, I went to the South Block, Central Secretariat at Raisina Hill in Delhi, to gift the then Chief of Army Staff, General Bipin Rawat, a copy of my book, Kargil. Accompanied by my editor Gurveen Chadda and son Saransh, I stood in the meeting room with all the 25 previous chiefs of the Indian Army looking down at me, stately and dignified, each one of them capable of making authors nervous with their gaze, even if it only came from a portrait on the wall. Two beautiful paintings marking India's two historic war victories, 1971 and Kargil, adorned facing walls. We were still looking around when the general walked in. Perfectly on time, looking distinguished in his olive green uniform. Casual and smiling, he reached out to shake hands with me, with Gurveen, and with Saransh, who was then a rebellious teenager and had absolutely refused to get his long hair cut for this meeting, despite repeated calls from his army officer dad to do so. Manoj was posted in Allahabad those days and was horrified by the thought of his son going to meet his chief with untidy hair. I apologized to General Rawat for Saransh's hair, but he just looked at Saransh and inquired, "Do you want to join the army, young man?" "No, sir. I want to be a commercial pilot." This from a boy who belongs to a family that has given generations of soldiers. I cringed. But General Rawat's smile stayed as warm. "That is perfectly fine. Not everybody needs to join the army or keep their hair short. All the best to you," he said, winning over a teenage fan right away. We had been told that the chief was following a very tight schedule and could give us just 10 minutes, which should be enough for a quick photo shoot where he would accept a copy of the book from me. Not only did he do that, but he also helpfully suggested that we stand under the painting of soldiers hoisting the national flag on the captured peak in Kargil. And he sat down next to me, looking relaxed and unhurried as he asked questions about the book and the people I had interviewed. Since he appeared so approachable, I asked him to verify a story I had heard about him, about how he had recently been stopped by a young soldier on guard duty in the cantonment, when he had been driving his own car, and asked to show his ID card. He laughed and assured me it was true, and added, "He was just doing his job, and doing it well." He then told us about a helicopter crash he had survived in Dimapur. The helicopter he was traveling in as corps commander had developed a snag and crashed soon after lifting off. He said that all he had suffered were a few cuts and bruises. All those present in the room that day marveled at the story of his miraculous escape. "It was the grace of God," he said, and waiting courteously for me to finish my tea, wished me luck and left. I did not know General Rawat much then, but I had liked him a lot. He came across as earthy, straightforward, and a genuinely nice person. No one had any inkling then that he would go on to become India's first Chief of Defence Staff, or that we would lose him in a tragic helicopter accident just 2 years later. Not in my wildest dreams had I thought that I would be writing his biography. but that was destined to happen. When I started writing Bipin, the man behind the uniform, I slowly got to know the COAS I had once had tea with a little better. It was while interviewing Lieutenant Colonel B.K. Singh, retired, who had piloted the chopper that had crashed in Dimapur, that I learnt that General Rawat had climbed out of the badly mangled cheetah with a blood-stained shirt and had assured Singh, "Just don't worry, these things happen. You did your best." He had then asked for another helicopter and done the trip a few hours later, completely unaffected by the crash. As you read this book, you will come across many heartwarming episodes from the life of India's highest-ranking defense officer, who most of us saw only in uniform. And though I am aware of the extreme emotions he stirred in people, many of them in uniform, he was indeed a remarkable man. He lived by his beliefs, took up stands for the army that many others in his position might not have taken, since they would be considered diplomatically incorrect, and he had the moral courage to stand by what he had said, face criticism, and take responsibility when it was due. General Bipin Rawat was a simple man. When he was young, he was quiet and reticent, never mentioning to anyone that his father was a general. He would always carry his own luggage, even when he went home. When he rose to the highest rank, he liked watching musical talent shows on television. He sometimes went to sleep sharing his bed with his dogs. He didn't care much about what he was wearing. His clothes were mostly bought by his buddies or by his wife. He was often ribbed by friends who told him that he had the hide of a rhino, at which he would just laugh. He insisted his daughters would use public transport and not an official army vehicle, even when he was COAS. I would like to request his strongest critics to read this book. They will then realize that he lived his life by the same rules that he applied to others. He might have had his flaws, and who doesn't? But the fact is that he was honest, straightforward, kind, and a nationalist who believed in doing what he felt was right for his country, which is more than what can be said for a lot of other people. To those who loved him, I would like to say, I hope this book tells you at least some stories that you didn't know and brings him back to life again, if only for a while. If that happens, I will be satisfied that my efforts have not gone to waste. Prologue. Radio Silence. 8th December 2021. Sulur Air Force Station, Tamil Nadu, around 11:35 a.m. It is a clear winter day. The sun shines brightly. A pleasant breeze rustles the leaves of the coconut trees. A fixed-wing Indian Air Force Embraer aircraft has landed on the main runway and is taxiing down to the VIP reception tarmac. It has come from the Palam Air Base, Delhi, covering a distance of 1,951 kilometers in about 2.5 hours. When it finally comes to a standstill in parking bay number 1, the pilot quickly disembarks and stands by the stepladder to receive the VIP guest he has flown. Group Captain Varun Singh, Shaurya Chakra, Directing Staff, Defence Services Staff College, DSSC, who has come to Sulur to escort his special guests back to Wellington, also stands beside him. General Bipin Rawat, Param Vishisht Seva Medal, Uttam Yudh Seva Medal, Ati Vishisht Seva Medal, Vishisht Seva Medal, Sena Medal, and Yudh Seva Medal, Chief of Defence Staff, has emerged at the door of the aircraft. All those waiting come to attention and salute as the highest-ranking officer in the Indian Armed Forces walks down the stepladder in his crisp uniform.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.